Welcome to Living Word.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth.
Well, hello, I'm Pastor Kathleen Casper, and this is Living Word. Living Word is a teaching program, and we seek through the study of God's Word to grow closer to him. Our God wants a wonderfully close, intimate, personal relationship with each and every one of us, and that is possible through Jesus Christ. And let's begin with a word of prayer. Good and loving Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise for the day. It is a glorious day that you have made. We rejoice, and we are glad in it. We rejoice in you. We praise you. We honor you. And we ask, Heavenly Father, that now your Holy Spirit would be our teacher as we continue our study of 1 Samuel. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, yesterday, we heard the biblical record of how David killed the giant Goliath. David had his focus on the Lord and on the Lord's ability to bring down the one who stood defiantly against the Lord and the army of Israel. David didn't have a sword, a spear, a javelin, or any professional military equipment. All he needed and all he had was faith in the Lord. With faith in the Lord, all David needed was a sling and a stone. A stone perfectly slung at the only place Goliath had no armor, his forehead. There the stone sank into the Goliath's skull, and there Goliath, the giant and the champion of the Philistines, fell, never to rise again. Yesterday, I spoke of our need to keep our eyes focused on the Lord whenever we meet the Goliaths, the giants we face in our lives. By keeping focused on the Lord, we can face any enemy and overcome them. We need not fear. Let's remember the beautiful words of Psalm 46, where David wrote, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. Yes. God is our refuge and our strength. We do not need to fear. All we need to do is hope in the Lord. Now, when I say that all we need to do is hope in the Lord, I am not saying that we are to sit still and do nothing except expect God to do everything. No, like David and many others before us, God has given us our assignments, which we are to carry out while we keep our focus on what the Lord is doing. We belong to God's army. We are his boots on the ground. He didn't call us to stay in our barracks while he carried out all of the missions. No, we are under the command of the Lord Jesus, and we're to keep our eyes on him and follow him into battle wherever he leads us. Let's not be counted as absent without leave, AWOL, when we're to be on the front lines or even in supporting positions behind the front lines. No, we've got to do what our commander commands us to do in his strength, covered with his armor, and knowing that God goes before us and is also our rear guard. After David killed Goliath, his name and his fame grew throughout Israel. This did not please Saul. In fact, Saul became so jealous of David that he tried to pin him on two different occasions to the wall of his house using his own spear while David played his lyre. Though he really had hoped that the Philistines would kill David for him, but they didn't, Saul eventually ordered that his own men kill David. This they did actually try to do, but David's wife, Michal, the daughter of King Saul, helped David escape her father's command by tricking the men into thinking that an idol that she had put in David's bed and covered up, she had told them that David was ill. But that wasn't the case at all. he was escaping. And after David made good his escape, we read in 1 Samuel 19, beginning at verse 18. When David had fled and made his escape, he went to Samuel at Ramah and told him all that Samuel had done to him. Then he and Samuel went to Naoth and stayed there. Word came to Saul, David is in Naoth at Ramah. So he sent men to capture him. But when they saw a group of prophets prophesying, with Samuel standing there as their leader, the Spirit of God came on Saul's men, and they also prophesied. Saul was told about it, and he sent more men, and they prophesied too. Saul sent men a third time, and they also prophesied. Finally, he himself left for Ramah and went to the great cistern at Sichu. And he asked, where are Samuel and David? Over at Naoth at Ramah, they said. So Saul went to Naoth at Ramah. But the Spirit of God came even on him, and he walked along prophesying until he came to Naoth. He stripped off his garments, and he too prophesied in Samuel's presence. He lay naked all that day and all that night. That is why people say, is Saul also among the prophets? 1 Samuel 20. Then David fled from Naoth at Ramah and went to Jonathan and asked, what have I done? What is my crime? How have I wronged your father that he is trying to kill me? Never, Jonathan replied. You are not going to die. Look, my father doesn't do anything great or small without letting me know. Why would he hide this from me? It isn't so. But David took an oath and said, your father knows very well that I have found favor in your eyes. And he has said to himself, Jonathan must not know this or he will be grieved. Yet as surely as the Lord lives and as you live, there is only a step between me and death. Now isn't that interesting? David understands the gravity of his situation much better than Jonathan does. Jonathan has assumed that his father would do nothing to harm David unless he told Jonathan his plans first. But Jonathan doesn't know how Saul's hatred of David has grown. Saul's hatred of David had grown so much that Saul would be willing to hide his plans to kill David from Jonathan because Saul knew how much Jonathan cared for David. And if Jonathan knew Saul's plans, Saul knew he would warn David, and David would succeed in escaping from Saul. Let's read the exchange between David and Jonathan. Verse 4 of chapter 20. Jonathan said to David, whatever you want me to do, I'll do for you. So David said, look, tomorrow is the new moon feast, and I'm supposed to dine with the king. But let me go and hide in the field until the evening of the day after tomorrow. If your father misses me at all, tell him, David earnestly asked my permission to hurry to Bethlehem, his hometown, because an annual sacrifice is being made there for his whole clan. If he says, very well, then your servant is safe. But if he loses his temper, you can be sure that he is determined to harm me. As for you, show kindness to your servant, for you have brought him into a covenant with you before the Lord. If I am guilty, then kill me yourself. Why hand me over to your father? Never, Jonathan said, if I had the least inkling that my father was determined to harm you, wouldn't I tell you? David asked, who will tell me if your father answers you harshly? Come, Jonathan said, let's go out into the field. So they went there together. Then Jonathan said to David, I swear by the Lord, the God of Israel, that I will surely sound out my father by this time, the day after tomorrow. If he is favorably disposed toward you, will I not send you word and let you know? But if my father intends to harm you, may the Lord deal with Jonathan, be it ever so severely, if I do not let you know and send you away in peace. May the Lord be with you as he has been with my father, but show me unfailing kindness like the Lord's kindness as long as I live. But show me unfailing kindness like the Lord's kindness as long as I live, so that I may not be killed. And do not ever cut off your kindness from my family, not even when the Lord has cut off every one of David's enemies from the face of the earth. So Jonathan made a covenant with the house of David, saying, "May the Lord call David's enemies to account." And Jonathan had David reaffirm his oath out of love for him, because he loved him as he loved himself. Then Jonathan said to David, "Tomorrow is the new moon feast. You will be missed, because your seat will be empty. The day after tomorrow, toward evening, go to the place where you hid when this trouble began, and wait by the stone Ezel. I will shoot 3 arrows to the side of it as though I were shooting at a target. Then I will send a boy and say, 'Go, find the arrows.' If I say to him, 'Look, the arrows are on this side of you, bring them here,' then come, because as surely as the Lord lives, you are safe. There is no danger. But if I say to the boy, 'Look, the arrows are beyond you,' then you must go, because the Lord has sent you away. And about the matter you and I discussed, remember, the Lord is witness between you and me forever." So David hid in the field when the new moon feast came. The king sat down to eat. He sat in his customary place by the wall opposite Jonathan, and Abner sat next to Saul, but David's place was empty. Saul said nothing that day, for he thought, "Something must have happened to David to make him ceremonially unclean. Surely he is unclean." But the next day, the second day of the month, David's place was empty again. And Saul said to his son Jonathan, "Why hasn't the son of Jesse come to the meal either yesterday or today?" Jonathan answered, "David earnestly asked me for permission to go to Bethlehem. He said, 'Let me go, because our family is observing a sacrifice in the town, and my brother has ordered me to be there. If I found favor in your eyes, let me get away to see my brothers.' That is why he has not come to the king's table." Saul's anger flared up at Jonathan, and he said to him, "You son of a perverse and rebellious woman, don't I know that you have sided with the son of Jesse to your own shame and to the shame of the mother who bore you? As long as the son of Jesse lives on this earth, neither you nor your kingdom will be established. Now send someone to bring him to me, for he must die." "Why should he be put to death? What has he done?" Jonathan asked his father. But Saul hurled his spear at him to kill him. Then Jonathan knew that his father intended to kill David. Jonathan got up from the table in fierce anger. On that second day of the feast, he did not eat because he was grieved at his father's shameful treatment of David. In the morning, Jonathan went out to the field for his meeting with David. He had a small boy with him, and he said to the boy, "Run and find the arrows I shoot." As the boy ran, he shot an arrow beyond him. When the boy came to the place where Jonathan's arrow had fallen, Jonathan called out after him, "Isn't the arrow beyond you?" Then he shouted, "Hurry, go quickly, don't stop." The boy picked up the arrows and returned to his master. The boy knew nothing about all of this, only Jonathan and David knew. Then Jonathan gave his weapons to the boy and said, "Go carry them back to town." After the boy had gone, David got up from the south side of the stone and bowed down before Jonathan 3 times with his face to the ground. Then they kissed each other and wept together, but David wept the most. Jonathan said to David, "Go in peace, for we have sworn friendship with each other in the name of the Lord, saying, 'The Lord is witness between you and me and between your descendants and my descendants forever.'" Then David left, and Jonathan went back to town. Now, beginning with 1 Samuel 21, we're going to be hearing how David literally does stay, one step ahead of King Saul as Saul pursues him to kill him. As we're going to hear, some people will be willing to help David, even losing their lives by doing so. But some will disclose his hiding places. We will also hear that though David is on the run, there will be those who will join with him. And about 400 or 600 of them, and 3 of them will eventually become known as David's mighty warriors because of the valor they showed and the victories they gained in battle. 1 Samuel 21. David went to Nob, to Ahimelech the priest. Ahimelech trembled when he met him and asked, "Why are you alone? Why is no one with you?" David answered Ahimelech the priest, The king sent me on a mission and said to me, no one is to know anything about the mission I am sending you on. As for my men, I told them to meet me at a certain place. Now then, what do you have on hand? Give me 5 loaves of bread or whatever you can find. But the priest answered David, I don't have any ordinary bread on hand. However, there is some consecrated bread here, provided the men have kept themselves from women. David replied, indeed, women have been kept from us, as usual, whenever I set out. The men's bodies are holy even on missions that are not holy. How much more so today? So the priest gave him the consecrated bread, since there was no bread there except the bread of the presence that had been removed from before the Lord and replaced by hot bread on the day it was taken away. Now one of Saul's servants was there that day, detained before the Lord. He was Doeg the Edomite, Saul's chief shepherd. David asked Ahimelech, don't you have a spear or a sword here? I haven't brought my sword or any other weapon because the king's mission was urgent. The priest replied, the sword of Goliath the Philistine, whom you killed in the valley of Elah, is here. It is wrapped in a cloth behind the ephod. If you want it, take it. There is no sword here but that one. David said, there is none like it. Give it to me. That day David fled from Saul and went to Achish, king of Gath. But the servants of Achish said to him, isn't this David, the king of the land? Isn't he the one they sing about in their dances? Saul has slain his thousands and David his tens of thousands. David took these words to heart and was very much afraid of Achish, king of Gath. So he pretended to be insane in their presence. And while he was in their hands, he acted like a madman, making marks on the door of the gate and letting saliva run down his beard. Achish said to his servants, look at that man. He is insane. Why bring him to me? Am I so short of madmen that you have to bring this fellow here to carry on like this in front of me? Must this man come into my house? 1 Samuel 22. David left Gath and escaped to the cave of Adullam. When his brothers and his father's household heard about it, they went down to him there. All those who were in distress or in debt or discontented gathered around him, and he became their commander. About 400 men were with him. From there, David went to Mizpah at Moab and said to the king of Moab, would you let my father and mother come and stay with you until I learn what God will do for me? So he left them with the king of Moab, and they stayed with him as long as David was in the stronghold. But the prophet Gad said to David, do not stay in the stronghold. Go into the land of Judah. So David left and went to the forest of Hereth. Now Saul heard that David and his men had been discovered, and Saul was seated, spear in hand, under the tamarisk tree on the hill of Gibeah, with all his officials standing at his side. He said to them, listen, men of Benjamin, will the son of Jesse give all of you fields and vineyards? Will he make all of you commanders of thousands and commanders of hundreds? Is that why you have all conspired against me? No one tells me when my son makes a covenant with the son of Jesse. None of you is concerned about me or tells me that my son has incited my servant to lie in wait for me as he does today. But Doeg the Edomite, who was standing with Saul's officials, said, I saw the son of Jesse come to Ahimelech, son of Ahitub of Nob. Ahimelech inquired of the Lord for him. He also gave him provisions and the sword of Goliath the Philistine. Then the king sent for the priest Ahimelech, son of Ahitub, and all the men of his family who were the priests at Nob, and they came to the king. Saul said, listen now, son of Ahitub. Yes, my lord, he answered. Saul said to him, why have you conspired against me, you and the son of Jesse, giving him bread and a sword and inquiring of God for him, so that he has rebelled against me and lies in wait for me as he does today? Ahimelech answered the king, who of all your servants is as loyal as David, the king's son-in-law, captain of your bodyguard and highly respected in your household? Was that day the first time I inquired of God for him? Of course not. Let not the king accuse your servant or any of his father's family, for your servant knows nothing at all about this whole affair. But the king said, you will surely die, Ahimelech, you and your whole family. Then the king ordered the guard at his side, turn and kill the priests of the Lord, because they too have sided with David. They knew he was fleeing, yet they did not tell me. But the king's officials were unwilling to raise a hand to strike the priests of the Lord. Then the king ordered Doeg, you turn and strike down the priests. So Doeg the Edomite turned and struck them down. That day he killed 85 men who wore the linen ephod. He also put to the sword Nob, the town of the priests, with its men and women, its children and infants, and its cattle, donkeys, and sheep. But one of Ahimelech's son, named Abiathar, escaped and fled to join David. He told David that Saul had killed the priests of the Lord. Then David said to Abiathar, that day when Doeg the Edomite was there, I knew he would be sure to tell Saul, I am responsible for the death of your whole family. Stay with me, don't be afraid. The man who wants to kill you is trying to kill me too. You will be safe with me. 1 Samuel 23. When David was told, look, the Philistines are fighting against Keilah and are looting the threshing floors, he inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I go and attack these Philistines? The Lord answered him, go, attack the Philistines and save Keilah. But David's men said to him, here in Judah we are afraid. How much more then if we go to Keilah against the Philistine forces? Once again, David inquired of the Lord, and the Lord answered him, go down to Keilah, for I am going to give the Philistines into your hand. So David and his men went to Keilah, fought the Philistines, and carried off their livestock. He inflicted heavy losses on the Philistines and saved the people of Keilah. Now Abiathar, son of Ahimelech, had brought the ephod down with him when he fled to David at Keilah. Saul was told that David had gone to Keilah, and he said, God has delivered him into my hands, for David has imprisoned himself by entering a town with gates and bars. And Saul called up all his forces for battle to go down to Keilah to besiege David and his men. When David learned that Saul was plotting against him, he said to Abiathar the priest, bring the ephod. David said, Lord God of Israel, your servant has heard definitely that Saul plans to come to Keilah and destroy the town on account of me. Will the citizens of Keilah surrender him to me? Will Saul come down as your servant has heard? Lord God of Israel, tell your servant. And the Lord said, he will. Again, David asked, will the citizens of Keilah surrender me and my men to Saul? And the Lord said, they will. So David and his men, about 600 in number, left Keilah and kept moving from place to place. When Saul was told that David had escaped from Keilah, he did not go there. Now before I read on, I hope that as I've read, you've noticed, as I have, that David now that he has an army of men under him and is literally on the run from Saul, isn't making a move without asking the Lord if he should make the moves he is thinking about making. Keilah is being attacked by the Philistines, and yet David asked the Lord if he was to be the one to go and attack the Philistines at Keilah. The Lord gave him permission to do so not once, but twice, confirming the original word David had received. When David heard that Saul had heard he was in Keilah and was planning to attack Keilah because David was there, David again went to the Lord to see if what he had heard was true and if the people of Keilah would hand him over to Saul. Having found out from the Lord that Saul was indeed planning to attack Keilah because David and his men were there, and that Keilah would indeed hand him over to Saul, David and his men left Keilah, and by leaving, David preserved the lives of all the people living at Keilah. Now, here's the point I want to make. David, at this point in his life, was not making a move without first asking the Lord if this move he was thinking about was in keeping with the Lord's plans for him. And this truly needs to be our attitude as well. Oftentimes we make our plans and we carry them out without ever thinking about asking the Lord if what we're planning to do is on His agenda for us or not. This could be presumption on our part, but it could also be that our attitude may be that, well, God may not be all that interested in what we do or what we might be planning to do each day. Not so. God is interested in every detail of our lives. He has the very hairs of our heads numbered, and He knows when a hair falls out of our heads. He knows when birds fall out of the sky. Our God is into the details of our lives. He really does care about all that goes on with us. The trouble is not with God, but with us. Somehow, we either don't think that God is all that interested, or that if we ask God whether He wants us to do what we might be thinking about, God may actually tell us not to do something, and our plans might be spoiled. I hope that our actions will be closer to David in these passages. He sought the Lord first, and then he acted upon what the Lord had told him. And we continue on, and we hear that David stayed in the wilderness strongholds and in the hills of the desert of Ziph. Day after day, Saul searched for him, but God did not give David into his hands. While David was at Horesh in the desert of Ziph, he learned that Saul had come out to take his life, and Saul's son Jonathan went to David at Horesh and helped him find strength in God. "Don't be afraid," he said. "My father Saul will not lay a hand on you. You will be king over Israel, and I will be second to you. Even my father Saul knows this." The two of them made a covenant before the Lord. Then Jonathan went home, but David remained at Horesh. And this is where we're going to stop today. And we'll continue taking up David's run from Saul and what he does in response to his enemy tomorrow. And let's just pray. Heavenly Father, we just give you thanks and praise for the day that you have given to us and the word that you have given to us. Heavenly Father, forgive us for every time we presume to do our own plans without giving you a second thought or even a first thought. Heavenly Father, we're just so used to doing things on our own, we forget you. And for that, we repent. Heavenly Father, we pray that we might be more like David. And certainly we pray that you would be forming and fashioning us into the image of your son, who didn't do anything. He didn't even say anything without hearing from you first. And so we ask, Heavenly Father, that we would be formed into the image of your son. Help us, O Lord. Help us. And now, Heavenly Father, I bless these people who have been listening with your blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. Bye-bye, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you for joining, Pastor Kathleen. Through this message, we hope that you will have come to know God better. God can be known and wants to be known by each person on earth. God is a communicator. He has given us the Bible, His Son Jesus, and the Holy Spirit as means through which He reveals Himself and His will to us. God is love. And regardless of what is going on in your life, God loves you and is concerned for you. He is as near as a prayer, and He can be trusted to be faithful to you. Living Word is a listener-supported program. Your prayers and donations are needed to keep this program on the air. Donations can be through the Living Word website or sent to Living Word, P.O. Box 3810, Alice, Texas, 78333-3810. If you have a question you'd like to ask Pastor Kathleen, a comment you'd like to share, or would like to purchase a CD of this message and have access to the Internet, Pastor Kathleen's website is www.livingwordradio.org. If you are in the area and would like to join Pastor Kathleen and the congregation she serves on the weekend, she is pastor of Emmanuel Lutheran Church in Alice, Texas.